I'm Yvonne van der Meer. I'm a professor at Maastricht University on the chair of sustainability of chemicals and materials. I'm also the scientific co-director of the Aachen Maastricht Institute for Biobased Materials that I will introduce to you in a minute. On the first slide, you see the Brightlands Chemelot campus. That is where our research institute, but also our educational programs are located. So it's not in Maastricht, it is in Geleen where we are hosted. As I said, my research group is part of the Aachen Maastricht Institute for Biobased Materials. That's an institute with seven expertise groups spanning the entire value chain from biobased materials, starting with the biobased resources and organic chemistry for building blocks, polymer chemistry, polymer physics. We have experts in textile engineering, and then my group is focusing on sustainability assessment. It's a joint institute of Maastricht University and Aachen University. So we have also input of Aachen University, mainly on the engineering expertise. The mission of my team is to provide suitable instruments for sustainability assessment, but also to provide the assessments themselves, sometimes for stakeholders outside our institute, but it can also be part of projects of my colleagues in the institute. And our ultimate aim is to guide the transition from a linear to a circular economy, from a fossil-based to a bio-based economy. And yeah, that's why we interact also with researchers and industrial representatives from other disciplines to exchange sustainability information with all the technical possibilities that are being explored. So renewable carbon plays an important role in our research program. In the beginning, my group was mainly focusing on shifting from fossil resources to renewable resources, and we still do that. But the past years, more and more research is focusing on end of life, improving that, improving recyclability, but also moving to circular concepts. And from an environmental point of view, two important drivers are climate change mitigation, but also plastic pollution, to prevent plastic pollution. And on the right side, I've shown a diagram made by the NOVA Institute. So our the volume of plastics that will be produced is expected still to grow and substantially until 2050. And at the same time, we try to change the feedstock for it. It can be covered by recycling of current plastics, can be covered by shifting to bio-based resources, and also shifting to CO2 as a resource. So the research portfolio of my group focuses on these different aspects and different projects. We do life cycle assessments, so we usually look at the whole life cycle of a product or a material, but these projects have different focus areas where it's difficult to model or where there are challenges, technological challenges that are changing the technologies, and then we look at what the effect is on the sustainability. So we look at resources, at green production routes. And in this presentation, I will mainly focus on the last two parts, the work we do on materials and on end of life of materials. So we use life cycle assessment a lot. I will say more words about it later in my presentation. We also use indicators for renewability, for circularity, and for environmental issues. Maybe if you only want to focus on a certain thing, a single indicator can be easier to tune your goals to, but most of our work is complete life cycle assessments. We also have a lot of efforts in data acquisition, because for proper life cycle assessment, you need enough data to do the modeling. We also do process modeling to fill data gaps, and we work with others to collect data. And what we also do is make decision support tools based on all assessments that we have done to make it usable for non-LCA experts. So the question we try to answer if we are in a bio-based or a circular project, okay, we shift or we change something, is it more sustainable? And as I said, we mostly use life cycle assessment for that. It's in principle a method to quantify environmental impact of a product, but it's also used for life cycle costing, so economic aspects, and there's also a framework for social life cycle assessment insofar as you can quantify social impacts. It's a standardized method, so there are ISO norms for it. At the same time, methodological choices can be different in different LCA studies. So if you choose different system boundaries, a different functional unit, or you use different data, you get different LCA results. And that's why a lot of people also get confused about LCA reports, because it can be that an LCA on the same topic can generate different results. What I also always find very important is that how the results are generated is transparent, so that as an external reviewer, you can see how the study was performed. And if you do not agree with the assumptions or if you have different data, that you can redo it with your own data. The advantage of LCA is that you can quantify impacts so that you also can compare impacts between different projects or different solutions. And if you aim for improvement, that you can also check if the improvement you made is actually also coming back in a better environmental performance. On the bottom, I've shown the basics of it. So you collect all the inputs and outputs of a full life cycle of a certain product. This is the ideal case. In a lot of situations, we don't have all the data, but that usually we describe this in the report. Then these are all transferred environmental effects. And in some reports, these are all bundled in what is called damage categories. So then you see a few indicators only. And in some other studies, you will see many more indicators. And that's also why some people find it difficult to understand LCA, because if you report all these indicators, it can be that your product is performing better on one and then performing worse on the others. I always find it important to have a complete picture. For instance, if you want to combat climate change, that you also know what the effects are on the other environmental indicators. So now moving more to LCAs of plastics. What you should know, what is mostly discussed for biopolymers is land use and land use change. These are not always reported in an LCA study. And by the way, for fossil feedstocks, this is usually also not done. So there's always discussion on that point in how far it has been modeled and if these models do not provide too much uncertainty in your model. Then an important point when it comes to circularity is the effects of marine littering, but also on land, is usually not included in the LCA report. And that's simply because we don't have data for it, so how much is leaking. More and more publications are coming up on that point, and we don't have a framework to assess the impact for it. And that's why I put forward here the marine impacts in LCA project, where I'm also one of the scientific committee members that is developing an assessment method for marine littering. And then the last point, if you want to model the full life cycle, you also need to know where these plastics go after use. So you need data on the waste management system, and these are usually also country specific. So you cannot just change your project from one country to the other without having all the data on the waste management system. In our studies, we make use of a model that was developed in the Wageningen University and Research Center on post-consumer plastic packaging recycling in the Netherlands. They concluded in their work that most of the contaminants in recycled plastics originate from packaging components. So they say these are thus design related, so we could improve it by changing the design of the packaging. So this model can be used to redesign the plastic recycling network and to move forward to a more circular economy. With some students, we also worked on the topic of recycling scenarios in life cycle assessment. It sounds very easy, but as soon as you are moving towards circularity, your product will have more uses than one. So it can be that first it is closed loop recycled and later it will have a second or a third use after mechanical recycling. In this case, your system becomes much more complex than it usually is in a linear system. So we had a student who developed an Excel tool for that. So if we know the second, third use of a product, we can set up a mass balance, and if you have enough information, also the energy balance of that life cycle. We also make use of environmental prices to make it more comparable, the different results. So we include all environmental impacts, but we calculate the environmental price as a single score to compare different solutions. Well, here we tested the model, but we can still not use it because we don't have enough data on the energy consumption of different recycling streams in the Netherlands. We have made some models out of this, but we have to add them to the current model. What we can already see is that the majority of the impacts are caused by the collection and the sorting of the waste. So that is before the recycling step of the products. We were also involved in a project called PEC-CE on recyclable multi-layer food packaging for a circular economy, where we did an LCA study with three scenarios. One is the current packaging that consists of PET and a PE mix, and that's currently incinerated with energy recovery. Then within the project, an all PE packaging was developed that can be mechanically recycled. And also people were working on chemical recycling, dissolution technology of the PET, so that we can improve the recyclability, the recycling of this packaging. We are still not finished with the LCA of this because we ran into quite some methodological issues that we now try to solve in other projects. What we could see is that the dissolution probably has a lower environmental price than the reference model, but we also cannot draw firm conclusions from that because the uncertainties are still too high in our system. And to show you that it's difficult to compete with incineration with electricity generation, one of the students calculated, you see that on the left side of the slide, the environmental price of incineration of polymers. So on the left side, you see different polymers. We look at the environmental price. So that's a single score for many environmental impacts. On the left, you see incineration only. And then on the right, you see incineration with electricity production. So then we correct for the electricity that is produced from the incineration and that replaces electricity from the Dutch electricity system. So you get a net benefit from that in some cases. So that's why the impacts from incinerated polymers are so low and why it's difficult to compete with such a system when you look at environmental impacts. We also worked on adding more data to the recycling system, in this case beverage cartons, by collecting data on based on a pilot that was done in the Netherlands to recycle beverage cartons. So these data you can add to the recycling model and then you get a more and more detailed picture on where all the polymers are going and end up in the recycling or in the waste system. Recently, a review was published on LCAs of food packaging by the United Nations Environmental Programme. They draw some conclusions based on the on LCAs of food packaging that have been done the past years. Well, there were some conclusions in it that you expect, like the type of material, the weight of the material are important. If a product is single or multi-use, has a huge effect on the environmental impacts, resources and transport. Of course, the end of life treatment, but also the geographical context. So in which waste system and energy system this food packaging is produced and also disposed of. There was also a recommendation if it concerns food packaging to include the food in the LCA, because a lot of packaging has the aim to keep the food longer. So if you want to include that effect in your LCA, you should also include well, the food itself in the functional unit. Apart from this, recycling of materials is a debated topic in life cycle assessment, how to do the recycling in the model. So that defines your system boundaries of your study, but also your modeling approach. So there are like simple methods to do it. It's called the cutoff system. And there are also more complex ways to do it, where you include a larger part of the system and where you take into account products that you are that you don't have to produce because you are recycling your materials. Here an example from a Japanese researcher who compared different ways of modeling it. He found out that on the left side you see a full life cycle model and on the right side a simplified system. The trends are the same for the green, in this case, greenhouse gas emissions, but the values are different. And if you make it even more simple, even the trends are not the same. So it's always important to look at how the recycling is modeled in LCA study. Well, apart from LCA, we also work on circularity metrics in my group. This is a circularity framework developed by one of my PhD students. So if you are interested in improving circularity, you must of course also be able to measure it. And what we found is that you can do that on many different levels. We call that value retention strategies in the model. And for these strategies, there are different indicators possible that you can use to monitor your circularity in your project. And we are also doing that with circular shoes of the Emma Safety footwear company. And lastly, we work on additives. I will not give any details, but additives are important also in a circular economy. Where are they going? Health effects are important. And usually additives are not taken into account in LCA studies. So one of our aims is to gather information to be able to model them and also to provide assessments of, in this case, 100% bio-based materials, including the additives. We are going to work also on biodegradable plastics. We just have launched an industrial doctorate program called Biobased Value Circle, where one of the PhDs is focusing for 4 years on biodegradable plastics together with the company B4 Plastics. And there we are also going to collect data on biodegradability and what that means for the impacts of the plastics. And lastly, I would like to draw your attention to a course that we offer on life cycle assessment, basic principles and users. We usually have a lot of companies joining the training. Next year is the last edition. It is an online training, so people from different countries can participate. And it is for people who have no LCA expertise, but would like to know the basics and would like to know if they read a study that they can judge the quality of it. So I would like to finish with, well, let's make it more circular, but don't lose track of sustainability. There are already tools available. Well, we heard about the Ecolyzer tool in the previous presentation that I was not aware of. There are also some other tools that you can already use. Of course, you can also do a life cycle assessment, but it's not easy. So usually you need someone who has expertise in it. And you can also use other metrics to measure circularity. And with this, I would like to end the presentation. And thank you for your attention.